It's unethical, the practice of having inside jokes that are so fucked up to people who don't even understand them, and like and basically making fun of people to their face, right? To me, that's really what's fucked up, and it's more fun. It's actually more to me, that's the crime here. The crime isn't that they're Nazis and they're racist, which they might be, and I'm sure they are accelerationists who are people who are just basically nihilists who don't give a fuck and want to see the world burn. And like, to me, that's probably a worse thing than being anything, because you really are anti-human and you're selfish.
What if I told you that one of the most successful NFT collections in the world was pulling off the biggest troll in internet history? No, not convincing people that this ugly shit is art or that it has any value. What if I told you that hidden within Bored Ape Yacht Club was a series of 4chan trolling, racist imagery, and white supremacy dog whistles? And with a deep understanding of cipher and cryptography, the founders of Bored Ape Yacht Club are making a mockery of the entire world, pulling the strings of the global elite, including celebrities, athletes, actors, and influencers. This story is extremely complicated for many reasons. The problem with accepting the truth I'm about to tell you is that you have to have extensive knowledge of 4chan, internet culture, and symbolism to even wrap your head around this and understand the motive. The most important fact I'm about to tell you that you must remind yourself as we go along is that the entirety of Bored Ape Yacht Club is esoteric. By design, it is only meant to be understood by a select number of people with specialized knowledge. And as you can see here, it is considered based when others with that knowledge connect the dots. Almost all of the absurdist references present in Bored Ape Yacht Club are glaringly obvious to the in crowd and are invisible to anyone who isn't terminally online. I might as well be speaking a different language if I don't prime you on every aspect of this elaborate cipher. Combine this with Bored Ape Yacht Club being valued at over $1 billion, and you have yourself the gold medalists of the Troll Olympics. I had my doubts about all of this. That was until I spoke with one of the top creative directors and internet artists in the world, who is an expert of internet culture, 4chan, and trolling. An artist who has worked with Kanye West, Grimes, and Tame Impala, among other creative projects that you've definitely seen. January 2022, a website goes live called GordonGoner.com. Signed at the very bottom was the signature of Ryder Rips. Ryder Rips is eccentric and is a trendsetter in every regard. He created the Deal With It meme, Dump FM, Internet Archaeology, and V-Files. When it comes to the internet, Ryder Rips is one of the most innovative artists of our generation. It's no secret that he uses internet culture and the nature of trolling to amplify his artistic messages. If there's anyone to educate others on iconography and the meaning behind art, it's Ryder Rips. And if I happen to be the founders of an NFT project manipulating the masses into asserting value on racist imagery, I would not fuck with him. For the past 6 months, Ryder Rips and other researchers have collected all of the data and sources that highlight Bored Ape Yacht Club's successful but depraved continued stunt. And I say continued because they still operate unchecked. 4chan is the gutter of the internet. Founded in 2003 by 15-year-old Christopher Moot Pool, this message board serves as a place where internet culture is born, discussed, and destroyed. Users on 4chan typically post as anonymous or anon. As they argue, the identity of a user adds nothing to conversations at hand. But the collective anonymous culture of the message board has devolved into a degenerate pit of despair. Along with anonymous identities, there is virtually no moderation. As a result of this, threads on 4chan spiral into some of the weirdest and most disturbing rabbit holes on the internet. So why even post? Well, as Ryder Rips described to me, trolling is a sport on 4chan. This point alone is necessary in understanding the motive behind Bored Ape Yacht Club. Throughout the internet's history, 4chan has been responsible for trolling mainstream media endlessly. One classic example of this was when 4chan tricked mainstream media into thinking the OK hand symbol signified white power. The media ran with it, and as a result, actual white supremacists adopted it as their own. An internet joke that illuminated a problem with mainstream media, their willingness to post anything, was taken literally and the meaning of the joke changed forever. Another example of this is comedian Sam Hyde being the ghost of Kiev. Lastly, let's talk about the benefit of the doubt. Imagine all of what I'm about to tell you is one giant coincidence. Somewhere along the grocery list of examples of Bored Ape Yacht Club being one massive alt-right inside joke is a point at which these similarities are no longer coincidences. Let's call this the tipping point. If I bring up one instance that highlights deliberate Nazi, fascist, or alt-right messaging, you may think to yourself, I see it, but that's a reach. So I ask you, what is your number? At what point do all of these examples become crystal clear in front of your eyes? For me, it was just one. First, let's talk about the apes as a whole. You don't have to look far on social media to see that many people believe the apes in Bored Ape Yacht Club are inherently racist looking. Remember, they could have picked any animal, object, or thing to make an NFT project. Monkeys? Really? It seems a bit random, but we're dealing with deliberate messaging. This is not a mistake. This is Damon Dash, the founder of Rockefeller Records with Jay-Z.
And then, I don't know if that monkey thing is like, because what's the biggest NFT?
Don't you think
that's a little condescending to our culture and a little bit?
We were just talking about that.
I feel like, is that a way a nerd is trying to get cute and laugh at us?
We were just talking about that.
Because either way, you should tread lightly with monkey when, as it relates to our culture, because it's a trigger for us. Mm-hmm. And they keep doing it. So first I wasn't like, and then I was like, why is everything a gorilla or an ape or a monkey? Why ain't it a penguin or like a panda bear or something? Why is it something that's been used to, you know, disrespect us for years? So I don't know, you know? Yeah. And when language is difficult for a creator, that leaves a lot of room for exploitation. You know, so that means a lot of people that can understand may take advantage of those creators that don't want to understand.
Do you guys realize for the last 2 years, they got black people to invest in monkeys and dogs while making fun of us and taking our money from us? But Doge was going to the moon. When y'all get done, go look at Bored Ape Yacht Club and go see the imagery of how it's connected to Nazism. It's damn near the same imagery, but they know we won't study long enough to say, and now look how many billions of dollars they made off of us and our culture. And then the music industry gonna come in with more NFTs and continue to rob us. All we need is us.
The reason people have made this conclusion is because of something called simianization. This refers to comparing ethnic groups to an ape or monkey. Simianization has been used throughout history to put others down in order to dehumanize them. You will see exactly how Bored Ape Yacht Club uses simianization to convey racist themes and undertones. But first, we must understand the culture in which these apes were born. In 2021, Bored Ape Yacht Club was launched on April 30th. Which is the exact day that Hitler died. The launch of Bored Ape Yacht Club was actually on the 23rd, with a week-long pre-sale, and they sold out before the 30th. However, they made it a point to tell the New Yorker that it was the 30th. I have shown this picture to various artists. This is Bored Ape Yacht Club's main logo that they use across all of their branding and social media accounts. Not too bad, right? How about now? Most of them laugh uncomfortably in sheer disbelief. The audacity to do this is mind-blowing. It does not take a genius to see that this Bored Ape Yacht Club logo is a direct copy of the Toten Kopf. The skull and bones represents death and was used by both Prussia and Nazi Germany as a military emblem representing death heads. I only mention Prussia because that will play out later when we examine some of the bored apes. Both logos also have 18 teeth. If you're unfamiliar, the alt-right, white supremacists, and neo-Nazis love alphanumeric code. The number 18 is a symbol of hate. More specifically, it's alphanumeric code for the initials of Adolf Hitler. One being A 8 being H. One thing to note is that both logos also have a rough edge, which is uncommon in circular emblems. It's just another characteristic that demonstrates they knew what they were copying. Bored Ape Yacht Club was created by a company called Yuga Labs. Like everything in this project, the name has meaning. A little bit about us to start off the new year and what's coming. What's the inspiration behind the name Yuga Labs? We're nerds, and Yuga is the name of a villain in Zelda whose ability is that he can turn himself and others into 2D art. It made sense for an NFT company. When I heard this, I was confused. I've played just about every Legend of Zelda game, and I could not remember for the life of me who Yuga was. You see, Yuga is a boss in The Legend of Zelda: A Link Between Worlds, the 17th installment of the Zelda franchise, available only on the Nintendo 3DS. If you're a self-proclaimed nerd or gamer, you wouldn't source your name from the most obscure Zelda game ever, let alone a game for the 3DS. Everyone knows that Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, Wind Waker, Twilight Princess, and even Breath of the Wild are the greatest games in the franchise. I could believe Ganon Labs, after the main antagonist throughout the entire series, Ganondorf, but Yuga? I'm not buying it. There is a specific reason they pick the name Yuga. On Yuga Labs' website, they pay homage to another project called the Hash Masks. This project was made by a Swiss company known as Suum Kuik Labs. This phrase, meaning to each their own, was on the gate of the Buchenwald concentration camp. This phrase was also used on the face of Prussian helmets. And Yuga Labs loved Suum Kuik so much that they even took their exact terms of service. Yuga has an entirely different meaning. The phrase Kali Yuga stems from Hinduism, and it refers to an age of conflict or darkness.
What is the period we're in now? Because it seems like it's coming to an end.
This is Kali Yuga, man. This is some weird shit that was predicted by the Bhagavad Gita. This is
good or Dharma wrong, Battle of the Gods, yeah. Ragnarok.
This is what happens in cultures. Like, they go through these pitches, these ups and downs.
The earliest mention of this phrase in internet culture was on September 11th, 2014, by an anonymous user on 4chan. In response to people being upset over Gamergate, Anon replied, "I know it is dark at times, but you just gotta learn to enjoy it, man. Embrace being the bad guy. Surf the Kali Yuga." Since then, the phrase spread like wildfire among the alt-right. First, it was made into a t-shirt by Vincent Vauquelin, who founded the French Dissent, an alt-right political party that operated from 2011 to 2021. Apparently, alt-right meme merch went hard, and the new design of the shirt in 2016 featured a toting cough. And in 2019, a Telegram group called Kali Yuga Surfing Club was created. See anything weird here? The Kali Yuga is one of the cornerstones of traditionalist ideology that was preached by René Guénon, a French occultist and philosopher who is credited for introducing the Kali Yuga to the West. During his life, Guénon moved to Egypt, became Muslim, and preached traditionalism, which consisted of extreme anti-Semitism and an admiration for ancient societies, which included hierarchies of class and gender. Guénon and Italian-born Nazi sympathizer Julius Evola are both revered and memed on 4chan. You'll find threads in the literature and political boards placing these two on a pedestal and recommending their works for a sense of woke pseudo-intellectualism. Often messages will be left with PBUH, which means peace be upon him, a common Arabic phrase. You see, surfing the Kali Yuga manifested itself on pole. It became a repeated phrase and dog whistle among users. In fact, embracing the darkness, or surfing the Kali Yuga, is a phrase that the alt-right has adopted in order to communicate a sense of collective. This might melt your brain, but stay with me. It's impossible to show the masses exactly what the founders of Bored Ape Yacht Club are doing without understanding Chan culture, or how 4chan acts as a think tank and hive mind. One of the worst aspects of Chan culture is pseudo-intellectualism. What you have is a bunch of trolls who haven't seen the light of day, that have collectively convinced themselves they are based, woke, and have the answers to this world. They find solace in knowing specific information compared to normal people, or normies. This is why it's considered esoteric. As a result of this, you have pockets of deranged people who study old texts, scriptures, and societies in order to extract archaic values and worship them. The founders of Bored Ape Yacht Club are terminally online, smart, assholes. I hate to admit it. The founders are clever, and I mean really fucking clever. The four founders are Gordon Gonner, Emperor Tomato Ketchup, Gargamel, and No Sass. You may be wondering, why do they all have obscure Xbox Live gamer tags? Well, if you think this is innocent, you're not ready for this. Number 1. Emperor Tomato Ketchup. Karim Adelay, software engineer. On the surface, Emperor Tomato Ketchup sounds like a Fortnite skin. In reality, Emperor Tomato Ketchup is the name of a 1971 film that is banned across the world for containing child pornography. It's about children overthrowing adults and establishing their own supremacy, in which a young boy in a fascist uniform sexually assaults a grown woman. And if you were to ask Tomato himself, he would say he got the name from a Stereolab album, which got its name from the film. Another example of plausible deniability. Number 2, Gargamel. Greg Solano, MFA in writing. If anyone is familiar with the Smurfs, then the name Gargamel might ring a bell. Gargamel is the antagonist who turns sentient beings into money. He is widely known as an anti-Semitic depiction of a Jewish stereotype. And as Ryder Rips pointed out, 4chan also uses the term Gargamel to describe Jewish people. A reoccurring theme that you'll notice is that this entire umbrella of Bored Ape Yacht Club trolling stems from 4chan behavior, which is based on inserting enough absurdity to create plausible deniability. Gargamel is smart, but he's a little sloppy. According to his Reddit post history, he posted a 4chan crypto meme before Bored Ape Yacht Club was even live yet, confirming that he's at least aware of the culture or uses 4chan. Greg Solano, or Gargamel, was a literature major in college and wrote his thesis paper on 2666, which is a book that takes place in Nazi Germany with a main character named after Nazi SS doctor Hans Reiter. He even expressed on his now defunct blog that he wanted to write a fiction novel that blends real history with imaginative events, which is similar to Roberto Bolaño's 2666. This could be a stretch, but I'm reminded here of your writing backgrounds. Do you think there's any parallel between your big conceptual breakthrough to design NFTs for what interests you, not some target demo, and the idea that in writing, sometimes the best stuff comes from channeling what you really want to see, not what some theoretical reader wants? Gargamel says, "Ever since the Bored Ape Yacht Club, we've seen like 1,000 different avatar collections come up, and a lot of them are really cool. But what we think was special, and what people could kind of read on top of ours, is that we didn't just throw 3D glasses onto apes. And we didn't have a long essay on exactly what this was, but we knew what it was. It's like Wittgenstein's 'Let the unutterable be conveyed unutterably,' or Hemingway's iceberg theory. We knew what this world was and why the apes are this way, and that somebody else might get a little tingle on their neck looking at it, thinking, yeah, this is kind of different. This isn't just random." In this interview, Gargamel literally just confirmed that Bored Ape Yacht Club is his medium for creative writing. First, the quote is cryptic, but it makes a lot of sense given the context of this project. "Let the unutterable be conveyed unutterably. Dog whistles, hidden meanings, fiction writing. Nah, man, they're just apes with 3D glasses. You don't understand crypto." In this statement, Gargamel quotes Ludwig Wittgenstein, an Austrian Jewish philosopher believed to have been the boy who went to school with Adolf Hitler from 1903 to 1904. According to writer Kimberly Cornish in The Jew of Linz, she alleges that Hitler alludes to a Jewish boy who is believed to be Wittgenstein in Mein Kampf. Wittgenstein's entire body of work consists of cipher, cryptology, and solving puzzles. Similar to how Bored Ape Yacht Club is one massive puzzle designed to be cracked for the sole purpose of stroking their twisted fanfiction writing boner. Second, he states Hemingway's iceberg theory, which describes exactly what they're doing. Iceberg theory itself is also a 4chan meme. Greg Solano also has written a book titled The Cinematic Art of World of Warcraft. To say he isn't a sucker for fantasy would be a flat-out lie. We know that Gargamel is a creative fantasy writer. We know that he wrote his thesis paper on a Nazi story. And we know that he wanted to create something similar, blending real and fake events. He literally quoted Ludwig Wittgenstein and iceberg theory, confirmed that there is hidden meaning, and that everything is deliberate in Bored Ape Yacht Club. Prior to Bored Ape Yacht Club, Greg Solano even stated he wanted to create a Lovecraftian-themed NFT project. And if you know anything about Lovecraft, he was a notorious white supremacist, often weaving his prejudices as the basis for his stories. The frustration that Ryder Rips and others have felt, myself included, with the public's perception of this criticism is immense. You can't begin to educate people on this when they're too ignorant to realize that they're being played. Bored Ape Yacht Club, in a way, is a social experiment in making fun of people who are easily influenced. Crypto bros and everyone who sucks off, technocrats included. It is a commentary on the number going up forever, or the wag me crowd, which lives by the slogan, we're all going to make it. This is a very real sentiment shared by thousands of people on the internet, which the founders of this project have profited off of immensely. All it took was celebrity worship, proper funding, fueled by a dystopian political agenda, to get fascist propaganda on the world stage. Let me be clear, I'm not saying buzzwords just to say them. This is what's happening. 3. Gordon Gonner or Wiley Arano, also a creative writer. The third founder of Bored Ape Yacht Club goes by Gordon Gonner, the same name Ryder used for the website piecing this all together. This was done for SEO purposes, so that when you type in Gordon Gonner on Google, Ryder's website pops up first. In an interview with Wiley from 2014, he stated, "The only book that I don't like is Mein Kampf, but I haven't read it." When asked innocently about books, he resorted to making Hitler jokes? Yeah, there's probably nothing to see here, right? This is just more proof that Wiley's attempt at edgy humor dates back to 2014. In an interview with Rolling Stone, Gordon Gonner stated he chose the name because it sounded like Joey Ramone, lead singer of the Ramones. It should be known that Bored Ape Yacht Club's connection to the Rolling Stone is not random. It's through Neil Strauss, author of The Game, who is apparently writing about the subculture of Bored Ape Yacht Club. Gordon Gonner is a full phrase anagram for Drongo Negro. Drongo is Australian slang for stupid, and negro means black. Drongo is also tossed around on 4chan and Reddit. It's not simply a random word. It is also conveniently a species of black bird. Another example of a hyper-specific double-meaning term or phrase in Bored Ape Yacht Club. There's not much else known about Wiley Arano, aka Gordon Gonner, besides loose leads that allege he's a crypto-fascist. And his dad is literally Don Arano, portrayed by John Travolta in Speed Kills. Both Gargamel and Gordon Gonner are writers and creatives, according to the CEO of Yuga Labs, Nicole Muniz.
Can you take me back to the origin story of Bored Ape Yacht Club?
It was almost exactly a year ago. Garga, who's one of the founders, texted Gordon with, hey, let's make an NFT. So Garga and Gordon were both really into crypto. They were really active in the community, but they are writers. That's actually their background. They are storytellers, they're creatives. And so like crypto was this thing that like they were fascinated by and they like loved, but they were never able to actively participate in.
Right. There was a barrier to entry.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Because it was technical.
Yeah.
And they're not technical. They're writers, they're creatives, they're storytellers. Like that's what they do.
So it's entirely critical that you understand the context of anything. So the issue with Bored Ape Yacht Club is that they're not providing any context. The context that they've provided is that literally it's meaningless. They said that these are just apes in a swamp who like drawing penises on a penis wall. That's the official story of Bored Ape Yacht Club from the mouth of Nicole, the CEO. Like, that's it. Like, end. Done. Like, there's nothing else.
They called me with, like, hey, we're gonna do this thing, and, like, you know, explaining the idea, and I kind of giggled and was like, oh, yeah, I mean, but people are just gonna draw penises. And that was it. Like, I was just like, I didn't think anything of it. We hung up, but, like, the stupid thing that I said that I never would have thought about transformed into, well, what if they do draw penises?
Yeah.
And where do people draw penises? And, you know, it turned into, well, it's a bathroom.
Right.
You know, it's a toilet stall. And it's a dive bar. And, but it's not a dive bar. It's a yacht club that's a dive bar. But it's in a swamp. And it's gonna be this, like, future vision of Miami. And, you know, it's all of these like bored apes. And they just created this like story and this world.
Let's play a game of I Spy. The cover of this Rolling Stone art is a direct reference to Hieronymus Bosch, who painted pictures like these in order to hide things in them. Spot the racist dog whistle. Ape hands are a racist dog whistle, alluding to the practice of Belgian King Leopold II cutting off Congolese hands for punishment in not working hard enough to produce rubber. The Congolese then started cutting off fellow African hands as it became a currency valuable to the Belgians in itself. Never underestimate the ability for Bored Ape Yacht Club founders to be this demented. Let's try this again. This is footage of the Bored Ape Yacht Club video game. See anything interesting? What's up with these bananas? Why is the bushel of bananas conveniently shaped like a swastika? 4. Sass, Zayshon Ali, software engineer. The fourth founder of Bored Ape Yacht Club goes by Sass, and going off the theme of hidden meanings throughout their entire project, this is also deliberate. SA is the abbreviation for Sturmabteilung, and SS for the Schutzstaffel. Sass, or SASS, is the combination of the two primary Nazi military divisions. There are two possibilities that explain the behavior of the founders. Number one is easy. They are neo-Nazis. Number two is a bit more complex, and Ryder believes we need new terms to describe what's happening. In other words, this is an internet troll's wet dream, post-ironic racism on the world stage. This means that this is a meme, but it doesn't look like one because there's nothing to indicate otherwise. This can also be described as Poe's Law. It's impossible to know if someone is joking unless they add an LOL at the end of a message to indicate how it's supposed to be perceived. In other words, Bored Ape Yacht Club founders are layering on the irony of troll behavior to the point where it's just doomed. The best way I can describe it is beating a dead horse until the horse comes alive again and then dies again from the irony. February 4th, 2022, Katie Natopoulos, a writer at BuzzFeed, wrote an article covering the identities of the founders of Bored Ape Yacht Club. And where exactly do you think she got her information from? Ryder rips. However, she stated, Solano and Arano don't appear to have any particular red flags, which, as we know, is a flat-out lie. Pressured by Guy Oseri, Kate Natopoulos ran a softball story in an effort to save face. The more degenerative side of 4chan, including white nationalists, enjoy participating in the cult of Keck, a metaphorical, fictitious religion that worships Pepe the Frog. Think of it as a tribe on 4chan who considers everyone else not in the know as normies. They wave the Kekistan flag, which is an exact ripoff of Prussia and Nazi Germany's war-mocked symbol. Their mission? Troll the liberals at all costs through meme warfare. By having shared symbolism and jokes, it is a way to communicate or dog whistle to other members that they, quote, embrace the principles of chaos and destruction that are central to alt-right thinking. The term Keck originated from World of Warcraft. When a Horde player types LOL to an alliance, LOL is then translated into gibberish spelling out Keck. This is because the two opposing factions in the game can't communicate with each other unless they are on the same faction. It just so happens that Keck is an Egyptian god that looks like a human with a frog head, hence Pepe. And guess what Keck was the god of? Darkness and chaos. Sound familiar? Surfing the Kali Yuga was not the only surfer innuendo that the alt-right adopted as lingo. In fact, they also used the word cowabunga to signify their alt-right beliefs to fellow members of the alt-right. It just so happens that one of Bored Ape's founder's wife had this exact lingo in her bio, which has now been deleted. And in September 2021, Bored Ape Yacht Club challenged the internet with a series of puzzles. Whoever cracked the secret codes would receive a Bored Ape Kennel Club NFT, a Bored Ape NFT, a Mutant Serum NFT, and 10 Ethereum. At the time, the value of these prizes added up to hundreds of thousands of dollars. This puzzle will demonstrate just how far the creators of Bored Ape Yacht Club are willing to go in order to play out their racist fantasy. This information is taken directly from this user's post on Medium. This whole puzzle started with a single stealthy tweet. somebody left a strange note at the bar. The image contains a message, "Come find me below," with the ciphertext of semicolon U8JJ6. This is a keyboard cipher, where if you look at the keys below each letter on a keyboard, you see that it spells slash Jimmy. Entering this after BoardApeYachtClub.com will take you to a new page, and you are able to load a puzzle game. Jimmy the monkey is back on his bullshit again. In the clubhouse, the game is a 2D screen where you can click on rooms and interact with various objects. Most of the rooms contained a puzzle. The boat room contains a single interactable object in the room, which is a wall of dancing men. If you know a bit about ciphers, it's fairly quick to recognize that this is a dancing man cipher. The dancing man cipher is from Sherlock Holmes. Decoding the cipher reveals the following message. "This isn't a puzzle clue. Suck on a banana, bozo. Love, Jimmy." This seemed to be a troll, as it was not used in the final solution. The party room has two interactable objects in it. The first object is a dog collar with the numbers 0010 on it. This is just the ID number for the exact NFT that you would win if you were to crack the puzzle. The second object is a party poster containing song lyrics. The puzzle gives a selection of song lyrics sorted in alphabetical order by word, with one of the words being replaced by the word monkey. Solving this puzzle involves taking each lyric word bank, identifying the song, and figuring out which part of the song the lyrics are referencing. You sort each word in that set of the lyrics in ABC order and figure out what word has been replaced with monkey. This results in the following troll message. "Wasted your time on this one, stupid apes." Entering the pool area presents you with two puzzles, one located on the inflatable duck in the pool and the other on a drink menu located next to the bar. This puzzle presents a list of duck-themed clues and their answer length. Going through and solving all of the clues results in the list below. With this answer set, reading the first letter of each answer gives the phrase "cocktails are shaken," which is a clue for the puzzle located next to the bar. Using the hint from the previous puzzle, we now know that this menu list is an anagram of cocktails. In addition, the text at the bottom of the menu indicates something extra was added to the drinks, hinting to there likely being an extra letter not used in the cocktail anagram. With there being 26 menu items, it seemed highly likely the extra letters or the cocktails used every letter A to Z for ordering when done. It is quickly realized all the cocktails start with a unique letter A to Z that, when put in order and reading the extra letters, gives orange liqueur used in spritz. Final answer? Aperol. Upon entering the kitchen, a sheet can be found lying next to the sink. This puzzle provides instructions on what to do. Begin by identifying the dishes that are clued on the left and filling out the blanks on the right. The extracted letters, highlighted yellow on the sheet, spell the phrase Gibraltar's Barbary, which is referencing a specific monkey that lives on Gibraltar, the Barbary macaque. Final answer? Macaque. In the library, you can start by clicking on the bust on the top of the shelf, which contains a puzzle scroll. This puzzle is a Mad Gab style puzzle, as hinted by the title, Bus Don Dush Elf, which, when read aloud, sounds like bust on a shelf. You can make four Mad Gab style phrases using one word from each column on the scroll. The output of each Mad Gab is its own clue to a word. This final output is yet again a Mad Gab, where ooze, six, sci, furs can be read as use six ciphers, a hint for the bookshelf puzzle. When you click on the bookshelf next to the fireplace, it shows you an enlarged version of the bookshelf. This bookshelf contains many different patterns throughout. As you start to group the patterns together, you will discover there are six separate puzzles using six different ciphers, as hinted in the previous puzzle contained in the shelf items. The monkey hands. There are six hands throughout the shelves using American Sign Language to spell weapon. Naval flags. There are six international maritime signal flags throughout the shelves that spell Nassau. 5-bit binary. There are six groups of books colored orange and green. These books are 5-bit binary, which provides 10010, 00101, 00001, 10011, 01111, 01110. These can be converted to their decimal equivalent of 18511914, which can then be further converted to letters to read reason. Clocks. There are six clocks through the shelves. Each clock face has a different time, with both hands clearly visible. Using the clock hands as a flag semaphore, you can obtain the letters to spell salute. Book titles. There are some books facing forward with their titles clearly visible, and after reading through the titles, you will notice some of the words are from the NATO alphabet. Echo, Mike, Bravo, Romeo, Yankee, Oscar. And when you extract the first letter of each NATO word, it will spell embryo. Morse code. Between each of the bookshelves is a repeating pattern of a lighter color. Each shelf is a separate letter spelled using Morse code. If you decode the Morse for each shelf, it will spell analog. Now that we have all the words extracted, we need to extract the final answer. Looking at the words for a moment, it can be seen that the first letter of each word can spell answer when ordered correctly. Since the first letter spelled answer, we extracted the last letters to see if it provides an answer to the puzzle. The extract is Guanan, which is a breed of old world monkey, and it's the name of Rene Guanan. The game room contained two objects you can interact with. The first one is a game called Jimmy the Asshole, which, after some playing, didn't appear to contain a puzzle. The second one is the game room puzzle. The flavor text for the puzzle is, "There are lots of games to play here if you can figure out the rules." It also has some pictures of Hangman and Tic-Tac-Toe. These are big hints for what you are looking for and what the solution is going to be. The solution for this puzzle involved taking each puzzle string and figuring out the puzzle rules that encoded the text. Here is one example. There are a lot of P's, so we want to analyze that first. You start by separating each line by P. We are looking for game-related words, so we can guess the two words here are card and canasta. With these two, we can deduce that the rule for this puzzle is to replace the first letter with P, which can then be reversed from the cipher, which gives the following clue, card worth 50 in canasta. The answer to this clue is Joker. However, we aren't done here just yet. Now we need to apply the same rule we discovered, replace first letter with P, to this answer to get a new answer out related to games. Applying the rule to Joker results in Poker, the actual solution to this puzzle line. Here is the rest. Taking the first letter from each solution, you get the following phrase, Drooper's apartment pal. Drooper is a character from the Banana Splits, and his apartment pal is Bingo. Bingo is an ape, so we can confidently determine the answer is Bingo. The attic is one of the more difficult puzzles, and before we dive into it, we first have to talk about the skeleton in the crawl space. The skeleton in the crawl space has a bunch of three-letter phrases and some numbers, with the flavor text of NTH plus EAT. We know that we're trying to combine the phrases to spell words, with the numbers most likely being the length of each word. There's really no approach other than maybe looking up words that start with or words that end with, but the best place to start was realizing that NTH and EAT were clued as being connected and could spell N, the, at. After that, it is mixing and matching until you get something good out. The output you get is Anastasia Steele really loves the hexes used in the attic. This is a reference to Anastasia Steele from 50 Shades of Grey, which is referencing that the hex color codes in the attic are gray codes. This is basically a second hint for Bought It, which you can see in the attic section below. The attic starts with an image with some pixels and flavor text about having to feel your way around in the dark. This is a reference for being blind and hinting towards the pixels being braille. The phrase you get out of using colored pixels as braille dots, beginners always unlock dim old tones. If you take the first letter of each word as hinted by the word beginners, you get Bought It, which is a type of cipher. This is the one puzzle you can right click and export the image, and it just so happens to be SVG. So we can extract the hex color codes accurately for the next step as hinted by the skeleton puzzle. Extracting all of the binary codes out and removing the lead zero, you get the following. Using Bought It encoding on the binary, you get the following. The only interesting thing we get is Calamar, which is another type of cipher. This suggests that our extract is valid, but the rest of it is cipher text. We can then use the string with a Calamar transposition solver, but without a key, it was just a bunch of guessing words as a key. Solvers of this puzzle got stuck here for a while until it was noticed that attempting some auto solves on the grid, assuming 6 columns instead of 8, resulted in the final 8 letters looking like a scrambled version of Visionaire. Given the first set of data gave us Calamar, and having it almost end with Visionaire now, another type of cipher, was too likely to be a coincidence. Putting some effort in manually with a 6-column assumption, you're able to get the following. Using Calamar key of 412563 or 214563 gives an output that spells Visionaire at the end, giving us the following possible strings. Cutting Visionaire off the end and taking the remaining letters, we try to decrypt the cipher using Visionaire and testing keywords relating to Bored Apes and the puzzle. Eventually, they landed on the following. Australopithecus. At this point, it's time to solve the final solution. Taking the answer from each puzzles and sorting them in ABC, we get the following words. Aperol, Australopithecus, Bingo, Guanon, Macaque. If we examine the answers, we can extract even more information about what they mean. Aperol is an orange liqueur that only got popular after World War II. This answer is different than all the others, considering it is a drink that is meant to be ingested. Going off that theme, perhaps this is a metaphor for taking the red pill, as it sometimes appears red in color. Aperol also just has the word ape in it. Australopithecus. Of all the different possible answers they could have chosen, they landed on Australopithecus. Here's a little anthropology for you. In 1931, Ludwig Kohl Larsen joined the Nazi Party and later undertook an expedition to German East Africa in search for a primitive man. In 1938 to 1939, he discovered Australopithecus afarensis at Laetoli without realizing the importance of his find. Ludwig attempted to prove that all people have a common origin, but that African people remained in the state of primitive men, while the Aryan race had developed. Such scholarship was at odds with most anthropological concerns of the day in Africa. He then later lost his position as professor in the course of the denazification after the war. Kohl Larsen is not highly regarded amongst contemporary East Africanists. Bingo. Bingo the Gorilla is a major yet final antagonist in the 2019 direct-to-video horror comedy film The Banana Splits Movie. Bingo and his friends are animatronics created by Carl to entertain children as the Banana Splits. However, after the show is canceled, Bingo and his friends start a killing spree. You want to know something even creepier? Bingo only has three lines in the movie.
I wonder how the show's gonna end.
Time's almost up.
Time's almost up.
Bingo's last and most famous words. The only words Bingo ever says sounds just like accelerationism.
Oh, that's a bingo.
Is that the way you say it? That's a bingo.
You just say bingo.
Bingo! How fun!
Guanon has double entendre. He's the father of traditionalism, bringing the Kali Yuga to the West, and Guanon is also a species of monkey. Macaque also has double entendre. Macaque is a racial slur and a type of monkey. By definition, there is a clear distinction of what type of monkey both Guanon and Macaques are. They are part of the old world classification of monkeys. In 2006, a Virginia senator was called out for using this slur. With close ties to Virginia, the founders of Bored Ape Yacht Club would definitely be aware of this political disaster.
You too have gotten in trouble with words that you've uttered. Let me bring you back to August 11th. You were at a campaign stop and a young man who was videotaping it for the web campaign was there also. Let's watch.
This fellow here over here with the yellow shirt, Macaca or whatever his name is, he's with my opponent. And let's give a welcome to Macaca here. Welcome to America and the real world of Virginia.
And here's the young man, S.R. Siddharth. He's a resident of Virginia, an American citizen, straight-A student at Fairfax High School, now goes to the University of Virginia. Critics say that Macaca is a racist slur and that you used it because he was dark-skinned. What did you specifically mean when you said, welcome to America and the real Virginia? Why did you use those words toward a dark-skinned American?
Tim, I made a mistake. I said things thoughtlessly. I've apologized for it as well I should. But there was no racial or ethnic intent to slur anyone. If I had any idea that that word, and to some people in some parts of the world was an insult, I would never do it because it's contrary to what I believe.
Well, where did the word come from? It must have been in your consciousness.
Oh, just made up. Made up word.
My theory is that the primate answers of this puzzle are a direct reference to the founders of the project, and Aperol could be seen as the red pill. The Boogaloo Boys were born on the weapon board of 4chan known as K. Think of them as paramilitary incels, or Chan LARPers. They can be classified by their Hawaiian shirts and absurdist meme styles to make anyone who calls them out look insane. It can be a very effective tactic when trolling. This Bored Ape Yacht Club shirt is an exact Boogaloo Boy Hawaiian shirt used to LARP by 4chan users. This is Ape 1488. The number 14 is a neo-Nazi dog whistle. It is a direct reference to the white supremacist slogan known as the 14 words. We must secure the existence of our people and future for white children. The slogan was coined by David Lane, a member of the white supremacist terrorist group known as the Order. The number 88 is is white supremacist alphanumerical code for HH, which stands for Hail Hitler. 1488, which is also included in the ADL database, or the Anti-Defamation League, is a combination of these two hate symbols.
But the fact is, guys, I've been on the internet 20 years. I know pretty much about every single different slur that's in the English language and a few in other languages as well. So not only do I understand all the slurs, I also understand the euphemisms, like 1488.
Here is where it gets really dark. What do you see on this ape? No, not the bloodshot eyes. This ape is wearing a prison outfit with the numbers 019807. If we take out the zeros, a practice in cryptography called null padding, we are left with 1987, which we can deduce is a year. You see, 1987 is a reference to the year that Rudolf Hess, a Nazi hero, died in the Spandau prison in West Berlin as a result of his conviction during the Nuremberg trials. It was destroyed the same year to prevent it from becoming a neo-Nazi shrine. Not everyone who has a bored ape is aware of the inherent racism. Let me point your attention to the sales activity tab. If someone is selling an ape, they set the price. Interestingly enough, there is a pattern of selling apes for variations of 88 Ethereum, ending prices in 0.88 or 0.14. This is a cut and dry example of esoteric racism. Ape 6969 features the same prison jumpsuit and a Prussian helmet with a shit-eating grin. This is a troll hidden in plain sight designed to mock everyone who looks at it. The odds of Ape 6969, which is a troll in itself, having both the prison jumpsuit and a Prussian helmet is statistically near impossible. Apes in the Bored Ape Yacht Club project are adorned with various characteristics. This can include clothing, accessories, eyes, faces. Anything you see on these apes can be randomly generated to produce the final product that we see as an ape. By design, some of these characteristics are more rare than others, which means more desirable, which results in a higher price. Some of these characteristics are harmless, but there is a definite through line with one characteristic in particular: headwear. The Prussian helmet is known as a Pikelob, which is a reference to the German Empire from 1871 to 1919. The Vietnam-era helmet features an Ace of Spades card attached to the helmet, which was a custom American soldiers started in World War II, but continued in Vietnam. In Vietnam, however, American soldiers would leave an Ace of Spades on dead Vietnamese soldiers. The card in the Bored Ape helmet has a letter J on it, which would indicate a Jack of Spades, not an Ace. The founders of this project are not sloppy writers, and wouldn't get history wrong if it meant they could include yet another racist reference. Maybe this explains it. Based on a 1938 decree in Nazi Germany, every Jew in Germany had to carry an identification card marked with J for Jewish at all times. The sushi chef headband is a Japanese headband known as a hachimaki. Hachimaki can have different Japanese characters on them to mean different things. There are six variations that are the most popular and commonly used. Bored Ape Yacht Club went with kamikaze to indicate Imperial Japan's suicide pilots. A sushi chef would never wear this headband. The safari helmet is a British or European pith hat used by the British Empire in colonizing Africa. And Belgium in the Congo, led by King Leopold II, who, as you know, cut off Congolese hands. The kami hat is known as a Ushanka, and with the sickle and hammer, it represents the Soviet Union or the USSR, worn during World War II while Russians were commanded by tyrannical leader Joseph Stalin. The fez is a potential reference to the Ottoman Empire, but there's also such thing as a Nazi fez. With all of these helmets and headwear, one can see a clear picture of Chan culture's fetishization of power and dominion of those they deem weaker. October 2021, music manager Guy Oseri, founder of management firm Maverick, who represents Madonna and U2, acquired representation of Bored Ape Yacht Club. This would include securing book deals, music, television, video games, and even movie integrations. This was a power play for Bored Ape Yacht Club because it legitimized funding and star power behind the project. With the connections of Guy Oseri, Bored Ape Yacht Club now had a way to control the media messaging around their project.
The project obviously has so much hype and so much support. There's also been criticism. Some people connected some of the images to racist tropes. I'd love to give you the opportunity to respond to that criticism.
It's apes, because aping in is very much a nod to this community, to crypto enthusiasts, to people who aped in early. So the story is about them. One of the founders is Jewish, one is Turkish, One is Pakistani. One is Cuban. Guy Osiri, who's one of the partners that came in later last year, is Israeli. I myself am Cuban, and I'm actually first-generation American. The idea that we're neo-Nazis or alt-right is offensive, it's hurtful, it's totally untrue.
That's really personal to you, that criticism.
The idea that you can't be racist, or even ironically racist, because you're ethnic is the saddest excuse I've ever heard. And this interview is bought by Guy Osiri. Here he is, pictured with the founder of D3. And this woman looks oddly familiar. Guy Osiri is even referred to as the fifth ape, a reference to the fifth beetle. When Ryder launched GordonGoner.com, Guy Osiri went off the deep end. Ryder Rips described to me a 2-hour phone call consisting of Guy Osiri screaming at him to stop digging into the project. After Ryder explained the symbolism to Osiri, he replied with, "Who am I to judge what art is?" And remember that Rolling Stone interview I mentioned? Gordon Gonner stated, "Are we the Beastie Boys of NFTs? Because right after our initial success, it felt like the Beastie Boys going on tour with Madonna." Everyone was like, "Who the fuck are these kids?" The Rolling Stone article then states, funnily enough, Madonna's longtime manager, Guy Osiri, signed on to rep the foursome about a month after Gonner made this comment to Rolling Stone. It's just so ironic that Bored Ape Yacht Club would go on to partner with Madonna's manager, Guy Osiri. Here is the family tree of Bored Ape Yacht Club. Greg Solano and Wiley Arano are from Miami. They met later in life at a bar arguing about literature. Kareem Adelay and Zayshan Ali went to University of Maryland together. Greg Solano also attended University of Maryland, but would go on to get his MFA at University of Virginia. The P.O. Box of Yuga Labs is in Alexandria, Virginia. The CEO of Yuga Labs, Nicole Munez, went to high school with Wiley. Mark Andreessen is the funding. Guy Osiri is the management and PR, and it's not a far stretch to say that Neil Strauss is their Rolling Stone media connection. He is also writing a book based on Bored Ape Yacht Club. Guy Osiri and Neil Strauss go back to 1998, when Guy Osiri was featured in the credits of Neil Strauss's biography on Marilyn Manson. One of the most mind-boggling parts to this ongoing story is celebrity endorsement. Everywhere you look, a new celebrity flaunts their hideous Nazi propaganda. I wouldn't expect them to know any better, but there's something going on underneath the surface. I know most celebrities are denser than a cement block, but you can't convince me they would all spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on these JPEGs just because of hype culture. So what's actually going on? In a Twitter Spaces video, Ben Baller, a celebrity jeweler, describes the process of receiving a Bored Ape.
Real talk, not once, not twice, three times I've been offered a Bored Ape through MoonPay. I had Adidas hit me up, my DMs, you know, on Instagram. "Hey man, you want to co-host Space with us, blah, blah, whatever. Told you own a Bored Ape." "No, I fucking don't." You know, hit me up. And it's just, I don't know what it was, but the fact that some of these super top tier all-star NBA players have them, and I was like, "Yo, this is all cap." I mean, there was an NDA they kind of send my agent and shit to, you know.
I mean, there's definitely NDAs and everything there, but I'm you know, positive there's, you know,
something. No, what I'm saying is, for me, if I was to accept, you know,
they wanted you to not disclose that they had purchased the ape for you.
Exactly.
Yeah, for sure.
They wanted it to seem like you bought it for yourself, because you liked it.
Which you know what the craziest thing about that is that a lot of celebrities who are going into this, they're probably just stoked to get the ape, and they don't even realize a lot of them probably don't consult their legal and shit like that beforehand.
Yeah.
But they're actually asking you to commit fraud on their behalf.
That's right. MoonPay has celebrities sign NDAs, or non-disclosure agreement contracts, revealing how they receive the ape.
"I just got my first NFT."
"Oh, you did? What was it?"
Through MoonPay. MoonPay.
Okay.
MoonPay, which is, I'm figuring, I did my homework.
Okay.
MoonPay was like PayPal, but for crypto.
In fact, the celebrities aren't even buying them, and they're lying through their teeth about why they bought them, all while committing fraud on MoonPay's behalf. Receiving a Bored Ape as an endorsement and not explicitly stating that you were compensated violates the Federal Trade Commission's laws. So next time you see a celebrity show off their Bored Ape, you can see who's a puppet taking advantage of their audience, all while unknowingly contributing to an apocalyptic political ideology backed by the technocratic elite. You may be asking yourself, who designed these apes in the first place. Surely, they would be the ones responsible for drawing the racist imagery, right? Currently, it is believed that there are 6 artists on the Yuga Labs team. However, there was an artist in particular that provided the base layers for the apes. Her name was Seneca. When confronted and shown the finished designs, she claimed she did not even recognize the final product and was shocked at the characteristics she saw. Seneca described payment from Yuga Labs as not ideal. After all, they were rolling in millions of dollars and she wasn't even getting a slice of the pie. However, it is speculated that Seneca received a $1 million bonus from the company after media outlets front ran her story. At the end of the day, Seneca, a very talented artist, was not responsible for this imagery. The Bored Ape Yacht Club project represents a sinister commentary on people's eagerness to hop on trends and projects just because it's in the spotlight. I say this is an ongoing story because on April 30th, 2022, 1 year after launching Bored Ape Yacht Club, Yuga Labs launched a metaverse called Otherside. If the date sounds familiar, it's because it's also Hitler's death day. The sprites available in the video game that doesn't exist yet are called Codas, spelled with a K. In music, Coda with a C means the end, and obviously the theme of transitioning from life to death or crossing to the other side. Their new metaverse also features Stonehold Jackson, a reference to the Confederate leader Stonewall Jackson, and Plot 1 is owned by Emperor Tomato Ketchup. Along the way, Ryder Rips was able to open the eyes of thousands of people by organizing the information and explaining the full context to the best of his ability, knowing all too well that the barrier to entry of this information is diving down the deep rabbit holes of white supremacy, the alt-right, and 4chan. But now, one thing's for certain. He was correct in telling me that Bored Ape Yacht Club is the biggest troll in internet history. Now that you know everything there is to know about Bored Ape Yacht Club's cute little social experiment, what can we do about this? Well, as it stands right now, the founders of Bored Ape Yacht Club operate relatively unchecked. That's because there's no real pressure. Their tactic of using plausible deniability and dumb excuses to deflect from the truth is about to change. Nicole Muniz, I really hope you had no idea this was going on. And if you didn't, that means your business partners strung you along because they think of you as a normie. It's unfortunate if you got roped into this. Guy Oseri, we will not be silenced. That's all I'm gonna say. Gordon, Garga, Tomato, and Sass.
I also think these guys are pussies. Like, I think they're feckless for doing this. It's like, they are, bro. It's like, go fucking do, like, why are you making this girl you went to high school with speak for you on tape?
I want every celebrity, actor, athlete, and influencer to burn their fucking ape. I wanna make such a fucking shitstorm that everyone from Steph Curry to Post Malone to Jimmy Fallon is forced to act. You see, this little price tag is contingent on you, the market, the people. But in their minds, it's the normies, the sheep that made them rich. So I ask you, are you a fucking sheep? I want each and every one of you to tweet hashtag burn BAYC on Twitter. Let's play their game. Burn means to destroy, but it's also something you can do with your NFT if you hold one. Not only will we sink Bored Ape Yacht Club because of their disgusting scheme, we will send a message. This message will be loud and clear. We will not be manipulated. To piss off ape profile pictures and amplify his own research, Ryder created Ryder Rips Bored Ape Yacht Club. Ryder won a DMCA takedown request against Yuga Labs, solidifying the point that you can't copy an NFT. Ryder also set his royalties to 0%. In this case, it's truly not about the money. He is also creating Ape Marketplace, saving people billions of dollars a year in gas fees. Oh, and if you see my profile picture, don't be fooled. It doesn't contain any racist imagery. It's also from the Ryder Rips Bored Ape Yacht Club collection. Silly goose, you can't copy an NFT. And I think I'll call him Caesar. You can even use him as your profile picture, because we're about to take over. We'll be right back.
dem Feind gelungen, die Front in breiter Formation zu durchbrechen. Im Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow. Und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Marsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steiners wird das alles in Ordnung kommen.
Mein Führer,
Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Es bleiben im Raum Keitel, Jodl, Krebs und Burgdorf. Das war ein Befehl! Der Angriff Steiners war ein Befehl! Wer schickt sie?
Das hier ist Wagen! Sie mein Befehl zu widersetzen! So weit ist das also gekommen. Das Militär hat mich belogen!
Jeder hat mich belogen, sogar die SS! Die gesamte Generalität ist nichts weiter als ein Haufen niederträchtiger, treuloser Feiglinge!
Mein Führer, ich kann nicht zulassen, dass die Soldaten, die für Sie verbluten...
Ist das Feiglinge! Verreiter und Versager!
Mein Führer, was Sie da sagen, ist ungeheuerlich!
Die Generalität ist das Geschmeiß des deutschen Volkes! Sie ist ohne Ehre! Sie nennen sich Generale, weil sie Jahre auf Militärakademien zugebracht haben, nur um zu lernen, wie man Messer und Gabel hält.
Jahrelang hat das Militär meine Aktionen nur behindert. Es hat mir jeden nur ein
Widerstand in den Weg gelegt. Ich hätte gut daran getan, von Jahren alle höheren Offiziere liquidieren zu lassen, wie Stalin. Ich war nie auf einer Akademie. Und doch habe ich allein auf mich gestellt, ganz Europa erobert. Verräter! Von allem Anfang an bin ich so verraten und betrogen worden. Es wurde ein ungeheurer Verrat geübt am deutschen Volke. Aber alle diese Verräter werden bezahlen. Mit ihrem eigenen Blut werden sie bezahlen. Sie werden saufen in ihrem eigenen Blut.
Bitte, Gerda. Jetzt beruhig dich doch.
Meine Befehle sind in den Wind gesprochen. Es ist unmöglich, unter diesen Umständen zu führen. Es ist aus. Der Krieg ist verloren. Aber wenn Sie, meine Herren, glauben, dass ich deswegen Berlin verlasse, irren Sie sich gewaltig. Eher jage ich mir eine Kugel durch den Kopf. Tun Sie, was Sie wollen.